Now let me turn to Ambassador Kamal Sibal. You have heard all of them, so you have a lot of points to react to. But let me read out two quotations from two former foreign secretaries. Shiv Shankar Menon said at Harvard, "We should not flatter ourselves that China is fixated on encircling India. She has greater goals, becoming the preeminent power in the world, and India as a major power is dealt with as part of that strategy. In other words, it is not a simple binary opposition, but a complex interplay between India and China, political, economic, security, other issues." Now, Shyam Sundar said, "We have to contend with the fact that relations with Pakistan are key to China's policy in the region. It is a proxy against India and brings in certain value to Beijing's ties with the Central Asian countries, as well as those beyond in the West Asian neighborhood. Now, with China's One Belt, One Road strategy and Maritime Silk Road, Beijing will continue to keep its relations intact with Pakistan." You're welcome to continue. You can even continue in next round, sir.
Well, I have been a little surprised by some of the statements Shiv Shankar Menon has been making and some of the articles that he's been writing. My own view is that one should not look at the India-China relationship as if we were an external impartial observer or an academician and choose language and formulations which are soft and ambiguous and try to give give reason to the other side. If as a national security, former national security advisor, his view is that the India-China border is the most peaceful one and we should not worry about it, then I'd like to know what has been the peaceful dividend from this peaceful border that we have. We have allocated huge sums now to build up our military infrastructure. We want to raise two strike corps, an independent armored brigade. We have opened up advanced landing grounds. We have placed our high performance aircraft in Tezpur. We are developing our strategic capabilities. So if the border is peaceful and if we are not to worry about the border, and if that is not a problem, then why are we making all these intensive military preparations? Clearly, it is because we feel that this is a huge challenge we face, and that China's claims on our territory are a source of huge instability in our relationship. Now, with regard to raising difficult issues with China, putting on the table, there may be a case of not making public some of the demarches we make that I may agree to, but then the point is that if you don't raise the difficult issues with the countries with which you have difficult issues, then how are you building up any relationship, any meaningful relationship? Then why are we raising all difficult issues with Pakistan, or why is Pakistan raising difficult issues with us? We must say, let's put aside all difficult issues. Now let's talk about the non-difficult issues in our relationship. It doesn't make any sense. I think there is also a problem of a gap between the kind of projection government has been trying to make of the India-China relationship of the kind that Shiv Shankar Menon has made in some of his articles and speeches, and public opinion. The public opinion sees the problems, and the government, I think also for legitimate reasons, doesn't want to add fuel to the fire and incite public opinion and make the management of the relationship more difficult, but at the same time, they have to be answerable in a democracy to public opinion, and therefore they have to point out where their difficulties and issues are, and they have to be seen to be raising these issues with the Chinese. And that is why I think the fact that Modi has been raising these issues, to my mind, is commendable. It's not necessary that results should be produced, or the legitimacy of raising these issues depends on the results to be produced, because if you look at the U.S.-China relationship, the kind of acrimony that is there also, in addition to all the substantial elements in the relationship. If you look at Chinese Foreign Office statements day in and day out, how they excoriate the United States on Taiwan and on the position in the South China Sea and whatever have you, take a look at those statements, but yet the relationship carries on. Now, importance of the border issue. Now, you look at China and the SCO countries, or the originally the Shanghai Five. China settled the border issue with these countries, with which it has contiguity in Central Asia. There was no disparity of power, no sense of threats involved. But since they wanted to build up a strong relationship with Central Asia, and they were looking afar, and now you see the results of that in terms of the energy relationship that they have developed with Turkmenistan gas and Kazakhstan gas and oil flowing into China. Look at the time when they settled the relationship with the border with Russia. It's not as if China had obtained the upper hand or Russia had become weaker vis-a-vis China at the time when they solved the border issue. It took a strategic decision to resolve the border issue outside the framework of a relative balance of power. So why is it that with India, China refuses to settle the border? And so long as it doesn't settle the border, we'll always be under pressure to become militarily strong, to spend more on defense, to worry about what China's intentions may be in the future. And there is no escape from this reality. The point made about cutting a deal with the Chinese, agreeing to leave Arunachal Pradesh with us, and we agreeing to handing over Xi Jinping to them, etc., etc. I think if such a deal was actually in Chinese intentions, then there was no need to set up the SR mechanism. There was no need at all. This could have been done. No. The interesting thing is that it is after the SR mechanism was set up, and in 2005 when the guidelines and parameters for settling the border issue were established, that China expanded its claims more vigorously, more aggressively on Arunachal Pradesh, calling it South Tibet, identifying certain regions in Arunachal Pradesh as administrative Tibetan, giving them Tibetan names, etc., etc. So clearly, and they've said repeatedly publicly that it's not a question of small concessions here and there. They are looking for big concessions, and at least the Wang, if nothing else. So I don't think I think one of the reasons why people say this is that to throw the blame on India, that India is not ready, India's political system is not ready, we'll not be able to settle the boundary issue, and they've been citing the problems with Bangladesh that over decades we're not able to do so, etc. So this is a very clever propaganda that is being carried on to shift the blame to India for not resolving the border issue because India is not ready. Another point I'd like to make is that we've been members of RIC, the Russia India China dialogue. We've been part of BRICS, and now of course we've become member of in principle become members of the SCO, but it'll take some time. But even with Russia, our friend within this grouping, and with other countries like Brazil. In BRICS before South Africa was included, being a friendly country, there has been very little positive fallout from these configurations on the sensitive issues between India and China. So you can keep engaging China within these organizations, you can find areas where your interests converge, and why not? We should work with them because that serves the interests of both countries. But in actual fact, the Chinese positions on sensitive fundamental issues relating to India remain adamant, and they are intent on pursuing their course. And to my mind, the CPEC, again, we tend to play it down. It is, from our point of view, a slap in the face of India, because by this they are, and they've said so, that this passes through an area which is not in dispute. So they have actually become adjudicators and arbitrators outside the United Nations on the territorial question in Jammu and Kashmir, and effectively in practice have handed over POK to Pakistan, totally contrary to the policies they pursue with regard to Arunachal Pradesh, which they say is disputed territory, and therefore no development program can take place, no leaders can. Their soldiers can be in POK, but the Indian Prime Minister cannot go to Arunachal Pradesh. This is the kind of absurdity of the situation. And so far as Zakir Rahman Lakhvi is concerned, when you read the joint statements, they talk about cooperation to combat terrorism, how it is the international responsibility, all nations should join together. And on an issue which is essentially a technical one, which could have embarrassed Pakistan a little bit because they would have to justify how Lakhvi got his bail, the Chinese blocked it. And yet tomorrow you will say that they will again talk about within SCO, within RICS, within BRICS, about how we can all fight together against terrorism. So there's a lot of duplicity, hypocrisy in China's attitude and thinking. And we should be very clear in our mind. But this is not to say that we shouldn't have a relationship with China. Of course, we must have a relationship with China. But the relationship is not easy. Even on the economic side, last year the deficit was $45 billion. This year already the statistics show our exports to China have fallen by 13% and theirs have risen by 20 or 28%. So the deficit will grow. So, and I'll conclude by saying that, frankly speaking, to my mind, China is the biggest challenge that we face in terms of our security and our regional interests. And this is something we have to contend with.